Good evening to you, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome once again to a very special edition of Beverly's Times Past. My name is Ed Josephs, and this evening we're here to talk about the Beverly Historical Society and Museum and a special event that's coming along their way. I have three guests with me this evening, all of whom are members of the Society, and I would like to introduce them. On my far right, Mr. Richard Rick Lord, who is the president of the Beverly Historical Society and Museum. Good evening, Mr. President.
Good evening, how are you tonight?
And next to Rick, we have Richard Symmes, and most of you people know Richard as a longtime host here of Beverly's Times Past. And Richard also happens to be the curator of the Walker Transportation Collection at the Society. Good evening to you, Richard.
Good evening, Ted, it's been a while.
It has been quite a while. And next to me, Mr. David Fletcher, who is the assistant or associate curator of the Beverly Historical Society's Walker Transportation Collection and a board member, I might add, also. And Dave will be the heir apparent, I believe, of the curator's position. But I think, Dave, you'll probably be in Prince Charles' position and probably have to wait till you're about 75 or so.
Mostly, probably beyond that.
Assume full title here. Now, Rick, let's get down to business here. We're here to discuss an exhibit that's forthcoming in the Society's calendar.
Yes, starting December 3rd, running through February 26th, we're going to have 25 train models like the one you see in front of you here. Wilbur Frey is the gentleman that made them all. He built these all by hand, no plans, blueprints. He did them all from photographs and his memory. He was a railroad worker for most of his life. We'll have 25 of these in our Memorial Hall. It's going to be a great exhibit. Appeals not just to folks that like trains, but anybody that's into art or mechanics or crafts or just building things. It's going to be a fun exhibit.
Now, when will this happen, Rick?
This will open up December 3rd, and it'll run through February 26th. We'll be open 7 days a week. Sundays will be only open from 1 to 4, and the rest of the week will be open during the regular Historical Society schedule.
I see. And the price of admission will be the same as
usual? Price will be the usual price of admission applies to this exhibit. Another thing that we're going to have with it, we're building a large turntable. One of the models will sit on the turntable, and children or adults will be able to spin it around using a crank handle. Be kind of neat.
I should say. Yeah. Most folks probably will never even have heard of a turntable, not knowing what that's all about until they see it at the exhibit.
Right. But that's how they turn the engines around and get them in and out of the engine house.
Absolutely. And Mr. Symmes, now, who was, or yes, I should say was, Wilbur T. Frey?
Wilbur Frey was somebody that we found out about over the years because of these models. The models began to turn up here and there, and we said, gee, those are fantastic. You know, who built those? And we found out that the gentleman lived up in Yarmouth, Maine. He had worked most of his life for the Grand Trunk Railroad, which is a Canadian subsidiary that ran out of Portland up to Montreal via Island Pond, Vermont. And during his career working on the railroad, he was involved in cutting up steam locomotives in the 1950s. And in so doing, he was able to sort of photographically remember how they went together. And at some point in time, one of his fellow workers asked if he could build him a model of one of those engines, because he knew that he had been a woodworker as a hobby. So he took a whack at it and built one, and the guy liked it and told somebody else, and he ended up building another one, and this led to another, to another, to another. And eventually, in his lifetime, he built around 200 of these. He really got going after he retired about 15 or 20 years ago and moved to Arizona. And out there in Sierra Vista, which is right near the Mexican border near Tucson, he was able to crank one of these things out in a matter of about a month. And at one point in time, he had 40 of them ahead of him, 40 people wanting an engine that he was somehow supposed to get around to building. And we heard about him that way, and we sent him some photographs and said, could you build us this engine? And after about a year, it came through some express company, which I forgot now, in a big wooden crate. And it's just fabulous. It's just like you see in front of us here tonight. And basically, that's what the man was all about. And he did this just as a labor of love. He charged a very minimal sum for these, and just enough really to cover the cost of his materials. And he said that he didn't do this for money, and he was just doing it for the sheer fun and enjoyment of it.
Yeah. Did you actually ever talk with him over through the telephone or any communication? I know later on, Rick, we're going to talk about an interview that mm-hmm. was done with him, but have you talked with him?
Yes, I talked with him about my own locomotive. I had him build one for me, and I did talk to him at length a couple of times on the phone. I never went out to see him, unfortunately, but we did send somebody out there who took a nice videotape, which you'll see part of tonight. And that, as far as we know, is the only time anyone ever sat down with Wilbur with a video camera and actually interviewed him in his workshop.
Wow.
Quite a fella.
He certainly sounds like quite a man.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. He was.
And how many of these trade models does the society actually have in their possession?
Well, we own 5 of them. And so we're having 20 other people loan theirs. People that live in this general area are loaning us their models. So we'll have 25 in one room, which I think is probably the first time that many of his models have been together in one place at any time. So it's going to be pretty unique.
Now, how would these other 20 odd people have gotten the models from Wilbur through your society? Is that how?
No. Again, like we did, found out through word of mouth, got a hold of Wilbur, said, would you build me such and such a locomotive, send him some photographs, and that was how they got theirs. There's one gal out in Stoneham who's loaning us hers, and she got hers because she and I worked together in Stoneham in the late 1980s, and I had mentioned this, and she said, gee, I'd like to get one of those for my dad. He's always lived in Stoneham. So long story short, we had Wilbur build a very old-style locomotive from the 1850s, it was actually named Stoneham on the cab window, and it was part of the Boston, Lowell, and Nashua Railroad.
Great.
So that's how she happened to have it, and she's loaning that to us, so we'll have that in the exhibit.
This fellow, Mr. Frey, sounds like a very accommodating fellow, doesn't he, Dave?
He certainly was.
Willing to do most anything.
Very humble gentleman.
Now, Dave, I'm sure that other than the three of you people sitting here, there are many more folks that's going to be involved with this exhibit. Do you want to name a few names and tell us how it's going to happen?
Yes, we actually have a committee that we put together. One gentleman is the Reverend Bob Hagopian, who's helped us. He's actually the gentleman who interviewed Wilbur many years ago. We also have Gary Thomas, who's the diner guy down at the Walker Collection.
Yep.
And Glenn Gray and
Ben Mary
from the Winter Museum. He's volunteered his time to help us out.
These names are real veterans of the society, are they not? They've been around for years helping out and pitching in.
Yep, yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. So the plans are all set to start putting it together.
Yep, actually, as we speak, Gary's adjusting the turntable that Rick mentioned earlier. Yeah. Glenn Gray is actually responsible for, we're going to have a mock-up of Wilbur's workshop, and Glenn Gray actually has built that.
Okay.
So we'll have a facsimile of his workshop and to give a flavor of what he did. Bob Agopian actually is assisting with Glenn with putting together the images. Another gentleman I forgot to mention is Steve Frazillo, who's a longtime Walker volunteer. He's actually helping us do the research because we're going to have photographs of all the locomotives, the actual photographs, and he's also going to be assisting us. And Ben actually assisted with Rick and Gary Thomason designing and putting together the turntable.
Right. Ben holds a title over at the Weather Museum, doesn't he, Dick?
Well, he did. He's recently retired from there. He's been there for, oh my goodness, 20, 25 years as curator of their train exhibits.
Yep.
And finally decided that he wanted some spare time to himself. And this past year, he did resign that position, although I think he still goes over there and volunteers occasionally. But yep. We called him up and said, can you come and help us with this? Because we knew he was interested in these. He had a couple of these models himself. In fact, one of them will be in the exhibit.
Uh-huh.
And so he was only too delighted to jump in and help us, and we're thrilled to have him.
Great. That's great. Now, Rick, all of this doesn't happen without a little funding.
That's correct.
I'm sure you'd like to say a few words about that.
Well, we have a whole range of sponsorship opportunities for this exhibit. And quite a few of them are still open, unfortunately. So if there's anybody out there listening to this and would like to help sponsor this exhibit, give us a call at the Society. We have packages ranging from $100 all the way up to $7,500 for museum title sponsor or exhibit title sponsor.
Uh-huh.
So we're still looking.
I'm sure that you must incur some expenses along the way. All of this is volunteer work, but
yes,
there's still some bills to be paid.
Oh, sure, the materials cost money. We're having to make some plexiglass covers for some of the models. Some of the people that own them that are loaning them to us don't have cases for them, so I'm getting those made. And the material costs are, you know, plastics have gone up in price with oil and everything else, so yeah, we have some expenses that we have to meet.
Yeah. Now, people who are watching this program and aren't members, they could cover two bases at once by joining the Society.
Absolutely.
And helping to support the exhibit at the same time.
Just give us a call, 922-1186.
Yeah, because I say that because I notice you've broken down your memberships now to people who support various organizations within the Society.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a great idea. Yeah. So you'll be happy to take any and all pennies and dollars and whatever?
Any way someone would like to support us, and if they'd like to come down and volunteer and help us out in setting this up, we'd love to have that
okay.
as well.
Why don't you give them the address and the mailing instructions and so forth once again.
Okay, we're at 117 Cabot Street, Beverly. Come down anytime during the hours of operation. Either ask for myself, Rick Lord, or Steve Hall, our director. One of us is generally in the building at any point in time.
Uh-huh.
And tell us what you'd like to do, and we'll be happy to accommodate you.
Oh, sounds like a deal. Hmm? Yeah, good. Now, Dick Symmes. Steve, in a minute, is going to cue in here on the model train here in front of us, which belongs to Dave, by the way, and he graciously brought it in this evening for our viewing. By the way, you said that was $175 that Mr. Frey?
Yes. When people think it costs a lot more, so that must cost thousands of dollars. And as Dick was saying earlier, this was actually a labor of love for him. He just wanted to recoup the cost of his material.
Yeah.
And it was just purely a labor of love. So it actually cost more to ship it out.
Yeah. Here. Dick, we were saying before the taping how Dick was telling us how the crating was kind of exquisite to the way they put it together to send it out, Dick.
Yeah, he actually put almost as much effort in building the wooden crate as he did in the locomotive models, and they were a real work of art. Even had rope handles with dowels with ropes running through it, piano hinges, and all inset and dovetailed joints, and yeah. I hated to throw mine away, but I had no room for it.
Yeah.
The thing was a work of art.
And of course, the train arrived safe and sound.
Well, not always.
Not always.
And despite that, it seemed like that was just a cue for the expressmen to try and break it.
Yeah.
They would dump it off the end of the back of the trucks or whatever. And several of them had minor damage. One of them had major damage, and he changed express companies after that.
Uh-huh.
And the engine had to actually be sent back, and great pieces of it had to be rebuilt
oh,
and put
boy.
Back together.
Oh,
but
shame, huh?
most of them came through with very, very minimal damage. Yeah.
Now, what are we looking here at out front here now?
We're looking here out front at kind of an unusual model, and when David was getting him to build something, I advised David, get him to build something different, because people kept asking him to build the same engines, you know, certain famous or important locomotives, and others were just forgotten. And I said, why don't you get something different? Well, this is something different. This is one of four locomotives that the Boston and Maine purchased from the Erie Railroad down in Pennsylvania during World War II. And this locomotive was bought basically because they were running short of power because of the war. And when they finally arrived, and they put them on the run between Boston and White River Junction hauling freight, they found out very quickly that they had bought a pig in a poke, because they were not very reliable. They have an unusual style tender for Eastern Railroads. It's called a Vanderbilt tender, and that's the part you see behind the cab, which holds the coal and the water, coal being the fuel and water being obviously used to make steam. And if you notice, the back part of that tender is cylindrical, and that's more usually found on locomotives from the West Coast. And it didn't hold much water, so consequently they'd be stopping for water two or three times on the run between Boston and White River. So that wasn't good. And the other thing was, they were really decrepit. They were loose as a goose. They said you could hear them coming 15 minutes before they showed up, because the rods would be banging and clanking. And
yeah,
they were just bad. And they kept them for a month, and they sent them back. They said, here, you know, these are worse than nothing at all. You can have them back.
Yeah.
So this is something that there's virtually no photographs of. I think there's maybe a half a dozen photos of them. And nobody has a model of one. I said, David, get them to do one of those. And so he did. And so we now have one of the only Mikados, which is the wheel arrangement on that engine that the B&M ever had.
Yeah.
They never had Mikados ever in their entire locomotive fleet until they got these four clunkers from the Erie.
Yeah.
And it was a very common wheel arrangement with other railroads across the country, but the B&M just never happened to have any.
I see.
So it's kind of unique in a lot of ways.
Yeah. Now, you said earlier that you own five, that is the society, and you've got 20 included
20 others
in the exhibit.
Mm-hmm.
Are they all going to be of this similar type model, or?
They'll be all over the place. We have the largest one is a Southern Pacific cab forward articulated locomotive, which is 8 feet long. Now this one that we see out in front of us is about 5.5 feet, so add another 3 feet to that and you've got an idea what this big thing is going to look like.
Yeah.
And the smallest engine that we have is one of the Mount Washington Cog Railway locomotives, which is tiny. It's like that long, and it's sitting on an inclined piece of display track,
yeah.
So it actually looks like it's climbing the mountain.
Yeah.
And I think that's also the only cog railway locomotive that Wilbur ever built.
It's beautiful.
It is, yeah.
Have any idea of how many he built in his lifetime?
We think, and Wilbur didn't keep good records, but we think he built around 200.
And I've heard as many as 300.
Yeah.
I mean,
there's
conflicting.
There's conflicting data. A friend of ours, Jimmy Smith, corresponded with him over many months, and both through letters and over the phone, and tried to put as much of it together as Wilbur could remember, because he just didn't write a lot of it down.
Yeah.
And also Wilbur says that some of the engines he knows were destroyed later on. The people died and someone else ended up with them and didn't want them, and they ended up going to the dump.
Yeah.
Which just amazes me, but anyway. He also built some what we call half models, which were just the front of the engine either coming out of an engine house door or out of a tunnel.
Yeah.
And people could use them like for bookends. You'd have the front of the locomotive on one and the back of a caboose on the other, and you could use them for bookends on a shelf. He did a couple of those. He did one caboose that we know of. He built one diesel locomotive that we know of, but he had no time and no interest in diesels.
Yeah. Isn't that fascinating, Rick? There he is out where in Oregon, actually, he was born, right?
He was born out there, yes.
And he then lived, where did he live?
He moved all over the place. He was in Europe for a while, then came back here, lived, in Michigan somewhere for a while.
Yeah.
Then moved to Maine, worked most of his working life on the Grand Trunk Railroad out of Maine, and then after he retired, moved to Arizona.
And he's passed away.
And he's passed away about 3 years ago now.
And here we are at Beverly celebrating his craftsmanship and his life to a certain extent here.
Exactly.
Fascinating. Mm-hmm. And those old sounds of the old steam engines, Nick, you and I can remember them coming into Beverly Depot, can we?
That's right.
Scare the living daylights out of you.
Oh, yeah.
When they came in.
Just as they came by you, there'd always be a big squirt of steam come out. And of course, you're only, 2-3 feet high when you're a little kid. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. All right, Mr. Fletcher. Tell us a little bit, again, it's been mentioned before, but people want to know the hours of this exhibit and how people can come or when they can come, what are they going to have to pay and so forth and so on?
Yes, the exhibit will be open all throughout the week. We'll be open during the regular hours. From December 3rd is the opening day till February 26th.
Which are regular hours are?
Saturdays, it's 10 to 4. Sundays will be open from 1 to 4. Mondays will be closed.
Right.
And Tuesday, it's Tuesday, Thursday, and Friday will be open from 10 to 4. And then Wednesdays will open from 1 to 9. And well, it's a $5 admission charge.
That's a reasonable price for a fantastic, I think, take, Rich. Huh?
Oh, I think, yeah. I think when people see this, it's absolutely unique. It's never been done before. It may never be done again.
Yep.
It's not easy to gather all these together and have people trust you with loaning them to you.
Speaking of which, this leads us into our next topic here. And you're a veteran of this, having put at least two exhibits that I know of together and countless more, I'm sure. The World War II exhibit in 91 and the Korean War and a few years ago, exhibit that you so successfully did. And Rick, what goes into creating an exhibit from the first time or first minute of, hey, we want to do this, you know?
First time out with the committee, you just brainstorm and think of all the possibilities.
Yeah.
Then we have to kind of scale it back to reality to figure out what it is exactly that we can accomplish with the manpower that we have and the resources that we have. Part of the reason we were looking for sponsorships for this exhibit were there are some things we would have liked to have done that we probably won't be able to. We would really, really like to publish a full-blown catalog of as much of Wilbur's work as we can. We'd still like to do that. If somebody wants to step forward and sponsor that, we will do it. But until we can find a sponsor, you know, that's one of the things that we had to drop out of this exhibit. There's just so much that goes into it, the logistics and the planning. And Richard has called people dozens of times to secure the loans of the different models. We've talked back and forth and gotten dimensions so that we can make the display cases for them. We're still scouting out all the different tables and the surrounds and things that we need to put on them, finding people to build the workshop and the turntable. It's a lot of work.
And I bet there are days, Dick, that you wish you hadn't gotten into it.
Oh. Absolutely, yeah. And you keep saying, this is it, this is the last time, not doing this again.
Yeah.
But always there's another one down the road.
Yeah, well, that's great. You both, all of you are to be commended for this because I know from just observing in past years the tremendous amount of work that Mr. Symmes here has put into his exhibits, and they've been very successful and very professionally put together. So congratulations to you all.
Thank you.
What's going on down there at the Society these days, other than this Frey exhibit coming along?
Well, down at the Walker Transportation Collection, this has been a very busy year. This past weekend, we picked up a humongous collection, and we're actually very honored to have it. Ben Crouch, a longtime supporter of the Walker Transportation Collection, and also very well known within the railroad or rail fanning community, unfortunately, he passed away this summer. And he left us with his photographic collection. He was a phenomenal photographer. A lot of his stuff has been published in national railroad magazines. He's had a number of books published on the Central Mass branch of the Boston Main Railroad, among other articles and whatnot. So for us to receive that is an honor, and we'll be able to carry his photographs and his legacy onward. We're also been busy cataloging our collections or digitalizing it, putting on a database, scanning the images. This allows us to better share make the images more accessible while
preserving the
original images.
Yeah.
Make it much easier for a researcher or anybody who's just interested in looking at anything of transportation. We received a grant from the MetLife Foundation to purchase some digital equipment. We've also received grants from the Amherst Railway Historical Society, and this has helped us purchase archival quality scanners.
Yeah.
So it's been those are the two major things that have been going on down there.
Sounds exciting.
So we've been very busy.
All of this started, what, 30-odd years ago, Dick?
Yeah, 35. 1969, Lawrence Breed Walker passed away, and it was his collection that launched all this and is named after him. And he lived in Salem, right across the street from the Witch House. And I knew him since the early 1960s, and he was looking for a place to leave his material to in case and when he passed away. And most of the organizations that he contacted wanted bits and pieces, but they didn't want it all. And he said, no, he said, it either goes in one lot or it doesn't go at all. And fortunately, we presented it to Ruth Hill, who was the longtime librarian at Beverly Historical Society, because I had become a member at about that time. And she said, you know, that would be a really unique thing to have. She said, I don't think any historical society in the area has anything like that. And so she talked Arthur Appleton, the president at the time, into it. And unfortunately, Mr. Walker passed away a couple of years after they had signed the papers. But that's how it started. And since then, we've added 25 other people's collections, ranging in amount from a shoebox of postcards all the way up to the collection that David just described from Ben Crouch, to the core collection. So we're in the process now of wetting the foundation of Cabot House so it will swell and provide us with more space, because that seems to be the crying need at this point.
Yeah. Mr. Walker, Lawrence Breed, lived kind of a bohemian life, did he not?
He was a real interesting person. He was an only child of a corporate lawyer who worked for many New England railroads in the turn of the century, the turn of the 20th century. And because of that, he was able to travel extensively. He was well-educated, started taking photographs of New England transportation subjects practically as a teenager, and did it up until the late 1920s, early 30s, when he contracted polio. And that really did him in. He became pretty much room-bound after that, lost most of his fortune trying to recover from it because there was no medical insurance in those days. And I met him when he was living, as I say, in a three-story walk-up room across from the Witch House.
Yep.
And he was just a fabulously knowledgeable and interesting gentleman. And his, I guess, knowledge of all New England transportation fields was really something that was contagious, because he got people all over the place corresponding back and forth, sending him pictures, him sending them information in a little newsletter that he put out every couple of months with a typewriter and 29 sheets of carbon paper.
Yeah.
And it was just a fabulous thing that he had going. And we're trying to carry on that whole idea that he started of sharing this historical transportation legacy with anyone who's interested.
I'm sure if he could know what's going on today, he would be a very proud fellow, Dick, to know what you've done with not only his collection, mm-hmm. but the 24 or 5 others that you mentioned that
I think he
have
would
been
be.
Added to,
yeah,
to
I
it.
I think so, and I hope we've done a good job.
And I would dare say that Rick, that collection down there probably is one of the best in New England. Would you not agree to that?
Oh, no doubt. It is an absolute gem, and every time I go down and open a file drawer down there, I find stuff that I never knew existed. Richard has been very fortunate in meeting all these other collectors and talking them into leaving their stuff to the Beverly Historical Society and the Walker Transportation Collection.
Yeah.
And these things are part of our past, and once if they ever went away,
yeah.
you'd never be able to recreate them. And yeah. now they've got a good home here yeah. in Beverly,
yeah.
and it's a great collection to yeah. go check out.
Yeah, and all due to this gentleman right over mm-hmm. here who got it all going and started. And you have a faithful band of Indians that help you now.
Oh, yeah. They're down there as we speak, being a Wednesday evening. This is our normal workshop session every Wednesday evening from 7 until 10, except the week between Christmas and New Year's. And people can come down from anywhere in the world and know that we're going to be there Wednesday nights between 7 and 10.
Yeah.
And that's worked out very well for us. We have people from all over. We've had requests from as far away as Russia, Germany, the Far East, Japan. It's amazing how the word gets out.
Terrific. Rick, now, you told me that we actually do have the voice of Wilbur T. Frey to listen to. And tell us a little bit about how that happened.
Well, Bob Hagopian, one of Richard's volunteers, went down to Arizona and shot some video with Wilbur in his workshop. And the interesting thing about it is Wilbur talks about how he puts these locomotives together and the materials and the tools that he used to build them. And I'm sure that people watching will get a kick out of watching them put these together.
Well, Steve Pike, who's out in our director's chair out there is going to put a little bit of that on, just to give us an idea of who Wilbur was.
Every time I hear the sound of a train coming down that railroad track, I get that faraway look in my eye. And I'd like to throw my hammer down and take off to some distant town and not even take the time to say goodbye. But I've got to think about my babies, about my job and my old lady, and how much she'd miss me if I was gone. And I love them more than anything, but I got this feeling about trains, and sometimes I wish I was on that train.